الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات ربه وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن دعا بدعوته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد beloved brothers and sisters in Islam السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Today inshallah we are going to speak about the objectives أهداف of Surah Al-An'am which is the sixth surah in the Holy Quran. And just by way of summary, we indicated that Surah Al-Baqarah talks about al-istikhlaf fil-ard. It talks about man's responsibility on the earth and his accountability to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we translated that into modern language and we said that man was appointed by Allah as his Khalifa, as his CEO, his manager, to manage the world in accordance with the program which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given in the Holy Quran and in the example of our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Surah Ali Imran then brings us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us to the fact that when we have this program, this Quran, and we are made to be responsible for running the affairs of the world, then we will have opposition. Lots and lots of opposition. And therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands from us in Surah Ali Imran to al-thabat, that we should be firm and steadfast in our application and carrying out the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in Surah Ali Imran, we also come across very strongly the command of Allah for jihad on the battlefield and ijtihad in the intellectual field. Fourth surah, sorry, that's the second, that's the third surah. First surah, of course, is Surah Al-Fatiha. Fourth surah is Surah Al-Nisa. And Surah Al-Nisa brings us to the absolute foundation of life on earth. It brings us to the foundations of man's relationship with man. And that relationship, Allah subhanahu tells us in Surah An-Nisa, cannot be established unless there is complete justice on the earth. And we know that. We know that even amongst ourselves, between friends, if there's no justice, there's no friendship. If you can't trust your friend, then he cannot be your friend. So justice from the two-person relationship to the 2 billion or 6 billion relationship is vital to stability and peace in the world. There cannot be peace without justice. Must be justice. First, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demands justice. And finally, our fifth surah, which is the last one we spoke about, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us that in order for us to be CEOs of the world, in order for us to be truthful and firm, in order for us to practice justice, we have to fulfill the obligations, both which Allah has placed upon us and which are placed upon us by other people around us. So if I have committed myself to do something, then I must fulfill my commitment. If I am a Muslim, then I am automatically committed to carrying out the 5 pillars of Islam. That is my commitment. That is my aqt that I have with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, inshallah, we will speak about Surah Al-An'am. Al-An'am, which means cattle. The word An'am means cattle. It includes everything on 4 legs, well, I suppose so, which man keeps as like cattle, like sheep and cows and camels, all these things which he keeps to feed himself with and to carry him and so forth and so on. These are called cattle. And inshallah, at the end of the surah, we will come to know why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called this verse the verse of the cattle. Because nothing in the Quran is just by way of names. No. Everything has a purpose, a wider purpose, and a divine wisdom which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put it in the Quran for us to discover. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alhamdulillah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Alhamdulillah. So this surah starts with words which tells us that all praise and all thanks is due only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Everything that we have, from the sun to the moon, to our health, to our mothers, our fathers, to our professions, to our wealth, everything that we have can be ascribed to Allah, and therefore our first hamd, gratefulness and thankfulness must be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah, why? Alhamdulillah alladhi khalaqa as-samawati wal-ard. First Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, glory be to Allah, thanks be to Allah who created the heavens and the earth. وَجَعْلَ الظُّلُمَاتِ وَالنُّورِ. And placed therein darkness and light. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ يَعْدِلُونَ. But those who reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they want to ascribe co-partners to Allah. They want to give Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala partners. وَالَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ مِنْ طِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I created you, He is the one who created you from clay. ثُمَّ قَضَى أَجْلًا. Then He gave you a time to live on this earth. And that time is recorded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَهُوَ اللَّهُ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَفِي الْأَرْضِ. He is Lord in the heavens and the earth. يَعْلَمُ سِرَّكُمْ وَجَهْرَكُمْ. He knows what you hide, what you conceal, your secrets, and what you do not conceal. وَيَعْلَمُ مَا تَكْسِبُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the way of your earnings. Allah knows what you earn and where you earn it from. That is the translation. Now this surah, Surah Ali Imran, or Al-An'am, sorry, is a very special surah in the Quran. First of all, it's a Meccan surah, consisting of 156 verses, revealed in Mecca. But there's some special things about the surah which we need to take note of. Abdullah ibn Abbas says that this is the only surah that was revealed to the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one night in Mecca. Now normally the chapters of the Quran are revealed piecemeal. Whenever it is required, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send a particular verse. And at the end, the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam put together all the verses and said, that verse should go in that surah and so forth and so on. But this surah was revealed in its entirety in one night. And we'll come to know why. And Abdullah ibn Abbas says that this surah was accompanied by 70,000 angels, who not only accompanied the revelation of the surah, but while bringing the surah down to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were making tasbih. And Abdullah ibn Abbas says the tasbih of the angels covered the whole of the earth. This in one single night. One can almost imagine the reverence, the heba, the reverence which the angels must have had for the surah, and the special nature of the revelation of the surah, Surah Al-An'am. When we read the first verse of Surah Al-An'am, Alhamdulillahilladhi خلق السماوات والأرض then my dear brother Muslim, from the beginning, we get a sense of the purpose of the surah. And we get a sense of the theme, the mihwar of the surah. And what is that? That is, huwa tawheedullahi azza wa jal. That is that the surah in essence deals with the tawheed of Allah. And to say that the tawheed of Allah is the oneness of Allah is saying 0.0000% of what tawheed means. Because tawheed doesn't only mean the oneness of Allah. That may be the name on the door of tawheed, but it's not tawheed in its entirety. Because there are many, 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 many people who say they believe in one God and believe also in the oneness of God, but they have no tawheed. They don't understand what tawheed means. And this surah will teach us the meaning of that tawheed. And tawheed means the absence of shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور. Tawheed means that we thank only Allah for the creation of the heavens and the earth. Tawheed means أَلَّا يَكُونَ فِي قَلْبِكَ غَيْرُ اللَّهِ تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى. It means that should be nothing in your heart except only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That your heart must be filled with a belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala repeats the question of tawheed 49 times. So 49 times in the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about tawheed. It's almost 30% of the whole surah. Therefore we know then that the reason for the revelation of this of surah Al-An'am with this kind of reverence and with 70,000 angels accompanying it, we understand that this surah is a very, very important surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ يَعْدِلُونَ, that the people who reject tawheed, their rejection, if you ask a Christian, any Christian, who do you believe in? He will say, I believe in God. If you ask him, is there only one God? He will say, yeah, Muslims believe in our God and we believe in the same God. If you ask the Hindus, they'll say, we believe in the same God. And all Muslims will say to non-Muslims, yeah, we believe in the same God. La hawla wa la quwwata illa ma'adallah. How is it possible for people who believe that God has a son to believe in the same God? How is it possible for people who believe that God is divided into three parts and they call it the Trinity to be the same God? No, it's not the same God. We don't believe in the same God. Yes, in interfaith sessions and in the world of interfaith, we are told that all believe in one God. That is a lie. It's a big lie. And it's a lie to mislead. Because if you want to become na'adallah, to change over, you'll say, well, I've lived in a society where we were told by our elders and our scholars that yes, the Christians and the Jews and the Muslims believe in the same God. How is it possible? If it was there, if it was so, if it was that the Christians, Muslims and Jews believed in the same God, then why do we have different faiths? Why will Muslims go to Jannah and the others will not go to Jannah? That's not fair. The same God, if all believe in the same God, there's an unfairness on the part of that God. If all believe in him, he should put us all in heaven. So, the practice, where did this practice begin? The practice of ascribing partners to Allah, Allah, is based on two theories. Why do people give partners to God? Based on two theories. The first theory is that God delegated some of his powers to other gods, to other beings. The Hindus, for example, talk about God of the sun, God of the moon, God of such and such, God of such, God of the women, God of the monkeys, God of all kinds of gods. They have a whole house full of gods. For everything there is a god. The Hindus started that. Then there were those who believed that God could not create evil. That God could not create any evil. They were the sun worshippers, the Zoroastrians. So they created a god which they called Ahriman, god of evil. Allah subhanahu, and of course the Christians believe that God is a trinity. And each one of these parts of the trinity, the mother and the father and the son, all of them are omnipotent. Meaning all of them are powerful, equally powerful. Now if all of them are equally powerful, why do we need the other two? One would be enough. If they're not all equally powerful and one needs the other one, then none of them have any power. None of them are worthy of all praise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alhamdulillah. Your God is a God to whom belong all praise and all might and all power. لِأَنَّهُ هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Because He created the heavens and the earth. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes all this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He is the creator. He's also creator of, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, He also created, we see darkness and light. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created darkness, referring to that which is dark, which is not good. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that which is good, which is light. And we know that evil is nothing but the abuse of the good things which Allah had given to us. Evil is not just something which is created on its own. Evil is something which man has been, I mean, your tongue is not evil. But lots of evil come from the tongue. Your brain is not evil. Lots of evil come from the brain. Your hands are not evil. Lots of evil come from your hands. And so there are many things that Allah SWT created, and there are many things which Allah created which for us is bad for us, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has an intention, has a reason why He has created it like that. And why He has put us in a particular situation in order to teach us the lessons of life. So this verse, this surah, first speaks to the mu'min. What does it tell the mu'min? What does it tell the believer? It tells the believer that this surah should increase your faith. Your real faith, your true faith. Billahi wa hubbak lahu. And it should increase your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa ikhlasuka fi ibadati. And your sincerity in His worship of Him and Him alone. The surah should make you aware of your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And secondly, it speaks to those people who say that all that we see around us came out of its own. That a thing called Mother Nature created all of this. That was the atheists, those people don't believe. Thirdly, it addresses a third group of people. It addresses the believer to increase his faith. It addresses those who do not believe that Allah created all of this. Thirdly, it addresses الناس الذين يؤمنون بالله ولكنهم لا يريدون أن يطبقوا هذا الإيمان في سلوكهم. It addresses people like us, Muslims, who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Listen carefully. Who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but do not wish to practice and implement the oneness of Allah in their lives. The butt people. Remember I talked about the butt people? Not double T. The butt people, one T. Those who say, yes, but. Yes, I make salah, but. Yes, I believe in Allah, of course. But I have another somebody that also is important in my life. Something else also. So yeah, Allah SWT, this is those people, the bad people. And we will hear the end of the surah. What Allah says about them. Those people who believe that iman can be divided into parts. One part for Allah, one part for that, one part. And we know that al-imanu la yatajazza. Iman cannot be divided. Iman is something waqara fil qalb wa saddaqahu al-amal. Iman is that which is in the heart and which is expressed in your deeds and actions. So today we have people who will say, but how can you judge people from what you see them doing? How can you judge people from this? When they themselves declare that they believe only in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even though their action may be contrary to their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People will say, like man said to me, a man makes sujood on a grave. Sujood. Put his head on the grave. Before this didn't happen in this country. When I was a young man, nobody made sujood on the grave. People went to the graves, they made dua, they put hand on the grave, rubbed on the grave. But nobody made sujood. Today, people say the ultimate respect for whatever and whoever is buried there. It's good to put your head on the grave. And this is on television, I saw it on national television. People do this. And many people believe that what is wrong with this? The argument is, how can you say the person is committing shirk when the person says La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah? That is only out of respect. And this is what Surah Al-An'am speaks about. It speaks about Tawheed in Aqeedah and in Tatbiq. It talks about your belief in your heart, in your mind, in your soul, and the expression of your tawheed. There can't be a dichotomy between the two. There can't be a contradiction between the two. You either have aqidah or tawheed in your heart or you haven't. You either do that which is in sync with the oneness of Allah or it's not in sync with the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the 12th verse of the surah, قُلْ لِمَنْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ قُلْ لِلَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and to whom belongs the heavens and the earth? قُلْ Say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it belongs to Allah. وَلَهُ مَا سَكَنَ فِي اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and to him belongs the night and the day. And whatever is in the night and the day. Everything belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he owns the heavens and the earth. And he owns the night and the day. In other words, what does it mean? It means he owns all the places and all the time. All time, whichever time there is, whichever time is at night or during the day, all of time belongs to Allah. And all of creation belongs to Allah. And if you believe that Allah is the possessor of time and of place, then read the following verse of the Holy Quran. Verse 16 of Surah Al-An'am. What does Allah say? First, you must believe that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs heavens and the earth, place. That all time also belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what is left? Nothing. Then read the verse. What does the verse say? قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ اتَّخَذَ وَلِيًّا. Allah says, if you have this kind of tawheed, then do you take other than Allah as your wali? Allah uses the word wali. I didn't use the word wali. Allah says, if you so truly believe that everything, time and place belongs to Allah, then why do you take another wali beside Allah? So people say, oh, you know, he doesn't understand the word wali. Shame, and he, you know, we know that he went to learn, but you know, he doesn't understand. So, all right, let's take all the meanings of wali and see which one we don't understand. Wali means friend, protector, supporter. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, let me say it in English, so will you take someone else as your friend? You say yes or no? Of course we'll say yes. Will you take someone else than Allah as your supporter and your nourish and your cherish? Of course no. So what are we talking about? Allah is our wali, and I said that last week. Allahu waliyul ladhina amanu yukhrijuhum minadh dhulumati ila an-nur. Allah says, I am the friend and the protector of those who believe. Yukhrijuhum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. I am the one who rescues them from darkness and I put them into the light. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you believe that place and time belongs to me, قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ اتَّخَذَ وَلِيًّا فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضِ. Why would you take somebody else as your wali? And for God's sake, why do you take dead people as your wali? Man is alive. You can say, well, this man is alive. You know, he's a good man. But where does this come from? That Muslims take dead people as their supporters and their friends. Dead people, dead. So of course they will say, you see, he doesn't understand what dead means. All these stupid, silly arguments. He doesn't know. People don't really die anymore. Good people don't die. They become God, because only God doesn't die. All these people who are dead and buried, they're all Allah's. La hawla wa la. All of them are Allah. Why? Because you say they don't die. They're still alive. They never died. And the only person who doesn't die is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, we don't understand what life after death means. That's something else. And Allah talks about that in the Quran. Allah says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الرُّوحِ. Oh Muhammad, they ask you about after death, what happens to the life of the person. They ask you. They ask the Prophet ﷺ, but, you know, what happens when people die? Are they still alive? Allah says, قُلِ الرُّوحُ مِنْ أَمْرِ رَبِّهِ وَمَا أُوْتِيتُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. Allah says to the Nabi ﷺ, tell the Muslims, what happens when a person dies, none of their business. That's Allah's business. Min amri rabbi. That's Allah's business. Don't scratch in Allah's business. That is what is called alladhina yu'minuna bil ghaib. Those people who believe in the unseen. If you don't believe in the unseen, look for another God. Because God is, Allah is unseen. So, this surah then In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, time and space belongs to Him. So who else will you take as your friend and supporter, wali? The creator of the heavens and the earth. وَهُوَ يُطْعِيمُ وَلَا يُطْعَمُ. He is the one who feeds you, you don't feed Him. قُلْ إِنِّي أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكُونَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ. Allah says to the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, say to the Muslims, I am the first to submit myself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَا تَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. And do not be of those who ascribe co-partners to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ إِنِّي أَخَافُ أَنْ عَصَيْتُ رَبِّي عَذَابَ يَوْمِ الْعَظِيمِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, say to them, O Muhammad, I fear to disobey my Lord the day of judgment, in fear of the punishment of the day of judgment. So, on the day of judgment, we will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in front of the Jahannam, A'adhallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse 27 of this surah, وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذْ هُقِفُوا عَلَى النَّارِ فَقَالُوا يَا لَيْتَنَا نَرُدُّ وَلَا نُكَذِّبْ بِآيَاتِ رَبِّنَا وَنَكُونَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and when they will stand in front of the fire, they will say, فَقَالُوا wish that we were, that we could be returned, so that we would not deny the signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we would be of those who believe. And we are commanded in this surah to have patience and perseverance when we face that which wants to take us away from our aqidah and our tawheed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, there are people in this world who disobey Allah, who rationalize about Allah, who find intellectual argument to support subtly the co-partners which they ascribe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they look at their life and they say to themselves, but you know, I do all these things, but look at me. I have a nice car, I have a nice job, I'm healthy, I go to the gym, there's nothing wrong with me. I do all these things that this man speaks about, but nothing happens to me. I've got a nice beautiful wife, I've got a nice job. Everything is nice, but I do all these funny things. I'm a doctor, I'm a lawyer, I'm a professor, I'm a surgeon. And if I maybe look at the other people who all say they believe only in Allah and put their trust only in Allah, shame, they're poor, you know, they beg, they sickly, or this or that happens to them. And he thinks to himself, I must be right. What I'm doing, I must be right. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks to him in the Quran, Allah says, فَلَمَّا نَسُوا. Verse 44, same surah. Allah says, Allah addresses him and Allah says, Falamma nasu, and when they forget, ma dhukiru bi, when they forget that what they have comes from Allah alone. When they think some of their riches come from their sheikh or their peer or whoever, that he has some hand in their success. When they forget that Allah is the first and the last, that to Him belongs what is in the heavens and the earth. What does Allah do? Punish them? No. Allah says, فَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبَوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. لَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ. Allah says, I will open for them the door of everything. The doors, abwab. I will open for them the doors of, they will flourish. when they make shirk, the Muslim, when he forgets. And then what will happen? Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hatta idha farihu. Until he or she reaches the pinnacle of enjoyment and pleasure in the world. Until they reach the pinnacle of materialism in the world. Everything comes to them. The doors of material wealth opens for them. What does Allah say? What happens then? أَخَذْنَاهُمْ بَغْتَةً. Allah says, I will come just in one moment and take everything away from them. أَخَذْنَاهُمْ. I will take them and what they have away. بَغْتَةً. In a wink of an eye. فَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْلِسُونَ. And they will be in total despair. So be careful to equate your material well-being to your belief. Many people do that. Or your outward spirituality to your belief. People say, I mean, I got an email the other day from a lady in England, in Britain. I don't know who she is. And she asked about the great people of the world that made such great contributions to society who are not Muslim, will they go to heaven or not? The answer is very clear. Inna deena indallah al-Islam. That the deen by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Islam. Wa man yabtaghi ghayra al-Islaman falan yuqbal min. And whosoever takes Islam other than Islam as his road, it will not be accepted from him. Wa huwa fil akhir bil khasirin. And in the year after, they will be of the lost ones. So we cannot look at a person and say, that man has got, mashallah, he always wears a turban. He's got a beautiful beard. We always see, he looks like a good practicing. That has nothing to do with his aqidah. Man can look like that. I was one day on a boat. Unfortunately, I have to admit to you that on this boat there was a casino. And if you want to go to the place where they eat, you have to go past this casino. So I went past the casino. And there was this man with his beautiful beard and his thing above his ankles. He's wearing it, mashallah. So no. And he was gambling. And the other time I traveled in my car to Rustenburg and I went past also a casino. I don't know why I get attracted to these things. And I wanted to go to the bathroom. So I went to the bathroom and unfortunately also had to walk past this place where they had all these machines. And lo and behold, who was playing these machines? Three women in full niqab. Full niqab, completely covered, in black, completely covered from head to toe. Maybe it was men covered in niqab either. And I said to myself, that is why it's important. You cannot look. I'm sure Abu Sufyan, I'm sure Abdullah ibn Ubay, who prayed behind the Nabi 5 times a day, but was the chief of the Munafiqun of Medina, I'm sure he looked, mashallah. So it's important that we live the real, we mustn't look like Muslims and act in what we do and incur the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala otherwise. MashaAllah, if you have a beard, wear it and practice the true tawheed and you will be the best of people. Inshallah, may Allah make us all of the best of people. So, Surah An'am then talks about the dangers of shirk. Now you may say, you see this shirk, he only talks, where does it say that Muslims will commit shirk? This is not for the Muslims. These verses, surah, not for the Muslims. This is for the non-Muslims. This is for the mushrikun. How can he apply these verses to the Muslims? Another argument. Allah says in verse 82 of Surah of Al-An'am, which is a surah. We're not talking about Surah Al-Baqarah or the other surah. Allah says, "Alladhina amanu." I'm sure even if you don't know Arabic, you know what that means. Amanu. Allah speaks about Alladhina amanu, those who believe, those who have iman. Alladhina amanu. Allah says, those who have iman, meaning who? Meaning the Muslims. What about them? Allah says, about them, walam yalbasu bi, walam yalbasu imanahum bi dhulmin. Allah says, those who call themselves Muslim and say they are believers, but do not clothe their iman in dhulm, in injustice, in darkness, in wrongness. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَلَهُمُ الْمُهْتَدُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they will be safe. They will be guarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will be protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they are the guided ones. They are the muhtad, they are the guided ones. Again we go over the ayah. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Those who say, لا إله إلا الله محمد رسول الله. And they don't dress the iman in dhulm, in injustice. So the Sahaba, when they heard this verse, they were very upset. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we are people of iman, and who of us do not do just injustice to ourselves? Allah says, if we do injustice to ourselves, then he will not, we will not be in his amn, we will not be in his protection, we will not be guided. They were very sad. They said, every Muslim does injustice. So the Prophet said, no, you don't understand what Allah means by dhulm. He says, it is what Allah said to his slave, what Allah's slave Salih, what Allah's Salih slave said to his son, Luqman said to his son, Inna shirka la dhulmun azim. Listen, what is the word dhulm here mean? Shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you people who believe, O Muslims, do not clothe your iman with shirk. If there's anybody here who feels I'm misinterpreting this, we have some brothers, some Arab brothers here, they can please correct me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O Muslims, do not clothe your iman. Do not go near it. If you think this is something to do with shirk, don't go near it. Stay far away from it. Because if you do that, you will not be under the amn of Allah, and you will not be guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even about the prophets, Allah says about them. What does Allah say about them? Allah says, وَلَوْ أَشْرَكُوا, if my prophets had ascribed anything to me, had made shirk about me, given me co-partners, لَحَبِتَ عَنُّ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ, I would have taken away from them all the goodness which they did. So, I think it's important for us to understand also, what is a mushrik? Because you know, this word somehow has a very great effect on people. And shirk, and kafir, and Muslim. What is a mushrik? When Allah talks about shirk, what does it mean? It means co-partner. It doesn't mean they reject Allah. No, it means they believe in Allah, but they give a co-partner to Allah. So the Quraysh in Makkah, they were mushrikun. They committed shirk. What did they do? They believed in Allah, but they gave him co-partners. Who are the co-partners they gave to Allah? The idols around the Baytullah. And the kafir, who is the kafir? The kafir is the one who believes in other than Allah. He believes in Jesus. Their Jesus, not our Jesus. Or in some other god. But the mushrik, the special person, he believes in Allah. وَإِنْ سَأَلْتَهُمْ مَنْ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ لَيَقُولُنَّ اللَّهُ. Allah says, if you asked Abu Lahab and Abu Jahl, who do you believe in? They also believe in Allah. They believe in Allah. And these idols, they're the daughters of Allah. So we say, we believe in Allah, and these dead people, they're the awliya of Allah. Same thing. We believe in Allah, and who are these dead people? They are the friends of Allah. The Quraysh said, we believe in Allah, and who are these idols? They're the daughters of Allah. We cannot get to Allah except through these people, except through the daughters of Allah. Therefore, we worship the daughters of Allah. No matter how you want to tell me and how you want to twist and turn around your arguments, it is exactly the same. You mustn't explain it to me. Explain it to Allah. Don't explain it to me. Close your door. Go on your masala and say, Ya Allah, this is my belief. I say La ilaha illallah, but I have this on the side. Like telling your wife, I married you, but I have something on the side. See what she'll tell you. Give her a co-partner and see what she says. It's a very serious business. So that's a mushrik. Belief in Allah, but in Al-An'am, that's why Allah has given this verse. Why was this surah called Al-An'am? It's a very important question. Why cattle? It has to do with Tawheed. What is the relationship between Aqeedah, believing and worshipping one Allah, and cattle? We've said cattle is what? Animals on which man rides and the flesh of which he eats. Camels, sheep, cows, oxen, so forth and so on. There is a very strong relationship between the two. What is the relationship? The relationship is that the Quraysh, people of Makkah, they believed that cattle was their source of wealth. We know that Arabs were reckoned to be rich or poor in terms of the number of camels they owned. That was the wealth of Arabia. And they believed that these camels that they had and other animals they had, لا علاقة لله تعالى بها. Allah had nothing to do with it. They believe this was something they had. This belonged to them. This was their wealth. This is their, what we call this is their thing. This is their thing. You know, they say leave their thing alone, you know. And what did they do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-An'am, وَجَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ مِمَّا ذَرَى مِنَ الْحَرْثِ وَالْأَنْعَامِ نَصِيبًا. And they gave Allah a portion of this. They decided how much they're going to give to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would say, هَذَا لِلَّهِ بِزَعْمِهِمْ وَهَذَا لِشُرَكَائِنَا. They said, this part of our cattle belongs to Allah, and this part belongs to our gods. So they decided. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَا كَانَ لِشُرَكَائِهِمْ فَلَا يَصِلُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. That which they gave to the shuraka, to the idols, didn't reach Allah. وَمَا كَانَ لِلَّهِ فَهُوَ يَصِلُ إِلَى شُرَكَائِهِمْ. And that which they dedicated to Allah, that went to the idols. So nothing went to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. سَأَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. سَأَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is the kind of judgments they made. Belongs to me, belongs to us. I will do with this what I want to do, and I will do it. I'll give to Allah that, and I'll give to Allah this. وَبَعْدَ ذَلِكَ. After that they said, وَقَالُوا هَذِي أَنْعَامُ وَحَرْفٌ حِجْرٌ لَا يَطْعَمُهَا إِلَّا مَنْ نَشَاءُ. They said that these crops and cattle, they are forbidden to everybody except whom we decide can eat from it. So they grew crops and their cattle. They said, we will decide who will eat from this. Biza'amihim, in their opinion. وَأَنْعَامٌ حُرِّمَتْ ظُهُورُهَا وَأَنْعَامٌ. And some of the cattle's backs, the back of the camel, they made haram for some people to eat. وَلَا يَذْكُرُونَ اسْمَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهَا. And some cattle, they didn't mention the name of Allah when they slaughtered it. Ah, so what does this tell us? This tells us that what they were doing is they said they believed in Allah. They slaughtered their animals, mentioning the name of Allah, but sometimes they decided they're not going to do it. وَقَالُوا مَا فِي بُطُونِ هَذِي الْأَنْعَامِ خَالِصَةٌ لِذُكُورِنَا. Sometimes they said, whatever this animal gives birth to will only be for our men folk. But if it's born dead, it's for everybody. In other words, they made all the decisions in terms of their cattle and their crops which they grew. So they believed in Allah, but they decided themselves what they wanted to do with their things. This is what I said in the beginning, where we were told in Surah Al-An'am that iman is not divisible. That you cannot have iman in your heart, but when it comes to what you do, it is different from what is in your heart. They had the camel, they had the camels and the hearth, the crops, and they did with that what they wanted. Yet they said they believe in Allah. Yet they wanted to give part to Allah. So what does it tell us? It tells us that no, you can't have a double life when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You can't have two lives. Either you have one life with Allah or you have nothing. If you have two lives, one secret life of your own and one public life with Allah, you are committing shirk. Giving co-part to Allah. That is why these Arabs in the time, the Quraysh in the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were called mushrikun, even though they believed in Allah. The last verse of Surah Al-An'am is a very famous verse, something we reach every day. Every day in our salah, and begin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ إِنَّ صَلَاتِي وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. We say, verily my prayer, my sacrifice, my life, my death, is for Allah alone. Now how could you say this every time you make salah? Yet we do something which is contrary to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. And we say, he has no partner. There's no part, no co-partner to him. That is what I have been commanded, said the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is why I'm the first to believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْ أَغَيْرَ اللَّهِ أَبْغِي رَبًّا وَهُوَ رَبُّ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ. Allah says, say, O Muhammad, do you wish for another Allah when Allah is our Lord and the Lord of everything? So surah, and lastly it ends off, وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعْلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala connects us back to Surah Al-Baqarah when he says, and I have made you, and he has made you his khalifas on the world. He has given you this world as a response. So he connects Surah Al-Baqarah with us. So we've gone through the stages from Surah Al-Baqarah to Nisa, justice, and the other surah, to Thabat, firmness in the road to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to the sixth surah, Surah Al-An'am, in which 49 of the verses deal with the question of shirk and the fact that your iman cannot be divided into parts. You cannot have one saying where you say La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah, but you wear something around your neck for safety. It's a contradiction. It's a major contradiction. How could you say that health and sickness and rizq and everything comes from Allah and protection comes from Allah, and when time is there, your time is there, everybody says, and you will not live a second longer, but I'm wearing this thing, you see, come on. I'm wearing, what is that? No, it's protection. From what? Who will protect you if Allah doesn't protect you? Who? A man who wrote something on a piece of paper and you hang it around your neck? That is why the struggle for iman is such a heavy struggle. الصراع بين الحق والباطل. The struggle between truth and falsity will not end until the day of Qiyamah. And your duty and my duty as Muslims is none other than the struggle of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was the struggle of love Allah. That was his struggle. And that's why he was sent as the beloved of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So may Allah guide us to understand the Quran. Of course, the important thing is that, I'm finished now, don't worry. For you to go back home and to read Surah Al-An'am and see how Allah talks to us in terms of staying away from shirk, that our belief and practice must be the same. And if it's like this, let us start bringing it together, inshallah. If sometimes our practice do not agree with our belief, we must make intention, inshallah, Allah subhanahu must guide us so that the two come into one. That our belief becomes exactly like our practice. Wallahu ta'ala alam, wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.